kiss my cheek to.
Thank you so very much, Teresa, and she will be performing again at 4 o'clock in the main hangar, so we'll stop down and see her full show. Teresa, thank you so much for being part of Warbirds Over the Beach 2024, and we do our flying activities here. The Messerschmitt ME-109 took off just a moment ago, and as it's beating up the field, we're going to have to send somebody after it, and that's going to be the Supermarine Spitfire, getting ready to take off in just a moment or two here. Don't forget, after the flying activities are over, there's still plenty to see and do here at the show. As I mentioned, Teresa will be performing at 4 o'clock in the main hangar. Also, the model club is upstairs in the museum and has some little snap-together models for the young aviators in the crowd. The Civil Air Patrol, the Odyssey Flyers, and NASA all have exhibits in the Army hangar. So we want you to stop by and see everything. There's lots to see and do here at Warbirds Over the Beach.
Pretty awesome sound of that double bass.
Designed by Billy Messerschmitt and Robert Lusser in the 1930s, it was the backbone of the Luftwaffe's fighter air force throughout World War II. In 1934, the Reich Air Ministry put out specifications for a modern fighter, and the Messerschmitt company came back with the Bf-109 V1 version 1. First flew in 1935, and it was a pretty revolutionary design for the time, featuring retractable landing gear and enclosed cockpit, and a low-wing all-metal construction. Early versions were powered by a Rolls-Royce Kestrel engine, but production models used German-designed Daimler Benz engines. The 109 saw extensive service from the Spanish Civil War through the end of World War II, and its adaptability allowed it to perform various roles. Of course, the orbital role was as a fighter. The 109 was primarily the fighter aircraft excelling in air superiority missions against enemy aircraft. It was also used as an interceptor, with its speed and firepower making it effective against Allied bombers. And later variants were also equipped to carry bombs, allowing it to perform ground-to-ground attack missions. And some versions were even modified for photo reconnaissance.
Yeah, it's been hard to fire off.
Well, as the 109 passes over our airfield, we're going to scramble our Super Marine Spitfire to go up and intercept that Messerschmitt.
That thing is down right now for me.
During the Battle of Britain, that being the ME-109 and the Super Marine Spitfire. Let's take you back to those dark days in England. After the fall of France, England stood alone in 1940. But standing alone did not mean surrendering. Ever defiant, here are the words of Winston Churchill.
That is the will of Parliament and the nation. The British Empire and the French Republic, linked together in their cause and in their need, will defend to the death their native soil, aiding each other like good comrades to the utmost of their strength. We shall go on to the end. We shall fight in France. We shall fight on the seas and oceans, 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 oceans.
Okay.
I guess Sir Winston got stuck. Anyway, during the Battle of Britain, ME-109s and Spitfires tangled over the skies of England, as they are doing here today. You can see both aircraft are relatively well matched in speed. Maximum speed of the Spitfire is 408 miles per hour. Of the ME-109, 398, so very evenly matched as far as speed goes. Rate of climb for the 109 was 3,400 feet per minute, while the Spitfire did a recovery climb of 3,700 feet per minute. So the Spitfire had an advantage, a couple of miles per hour in speed and an ability to climb much quicker.
That? No, actually, you're the second person today asked me about the 38. So.
Just hard to get?
Well, there are very few of them that have been found. And actually, the founder of the museum, my understanding, had found one, a 38F in Papua New Guinea. He and his Australian partner found it, recovered it, got it back to Australia. Australian law, if you have a piece of property, you have to, every 2 years, lay claim to it. Well, Mr. Yagan thought that his business partner was looking after him and everything else. Didn't go back to Australia for 3 years. Come back, yes. You know, how we come up with our aircraft? My aircraft, Mike. Yeah. Wow.
One of the advantages that the British had is the advanced radar technology that they developed before World War II. In fact, it was their radar was so secretive that British engineers actually bundled up some of the prototypes and almost all of the files and information about how they developed radar and shipped it off to the United States, fearing that there might be an invasion of the home islands, and as the information about radar would fall into enemy hands. The engineers at MIT took the research that the British had already done and continued to develop radar. Now, radar in the British home islands gave the fighters an advantage in that they didn't need to
fly up and find the enemy. They knew where they were coming from what direction, what speed, what altitude, and they were able to launch interceptors as they got closer, rather than using precious fuel to try and find the enemy force. So the British Spitfires and Hurricanes could easily go from numerous airfields in England and intercept dogfighters of the war. The 109G, or Gustav, and that's the supply here today, is the most produced here.
Heavier armament and the more powerful engine.
And the follow-up production variant introduced in late 1944, which really improved its speed and element, was the 109K, or Purpurs. But by that time, German losses in both aircraft and experienced pilots were difficult for the Luftwaffe. Taking off now is the Yak-3. It's one of the most effective and celebrated Soviet fighter aircraft of World War II. Known for the performance and agility, it played a crucial role in the Red Air Force's success on the Eastern Front. In air-to-air combat, he was also able to provide close air support to Soviet ground forces, lightweight construction, and powerful engines with a superior speed.
That was the danger.
Of course, if you're ever sitting around a campfire at an aviation event, and you want to get into a spirited discussion, you can ask which was the best of all the World War II fighters. Was it the Supermarine Spitfire? Was it the B-51 Mustang? Maybe it was the Yak. You can get some cool. What was almost called hunter-killer missions. And that was to fly into Germany and entice. And we want to thank all those of you who load up some of the cargo. The company that we've got there. Appreciate as many help in hand. Quick work uploading that aircraft. It's going to take off in just a few moments. We'll talk a little more about the capabilities of the C-47, especially during D-Day and market curve.